dear students, I am Shweta Sharma from Government Girls Inter College, Bareilly. A very warm welcome to all of you in this session. Today, I am going to present lesson 4 from the prose section of your English book, and the title of the lesson is Socrates. Have a very quick look at the contents of today's section. So children, today I would like to put two very interesting as well as two very important questions before you. My first question is, what do you understand by AD and BC? BC is before Christ or before the birth of Jesus Christ, and AD is the short form of a Latin phrase, Anno Domini, and the meaning of this phrase is after the birth of the Lord. And my second question is, what is the capital of Greece? This question is very easy, and the answer of this question is Athens. This is actually the greatest philosopher of the world, Socrates. Socrates was born in Athens before 470 years Jesus Christ was born. And about this man, about this great philosopher, we are going to study today. And this is the lady, Rhoda Power, the author of this lesson, who is considered as the novelist of children, was born on May 29, 1890. She got her education from Oxford High School and St. Andrews University, Scotland. After leading a very successful literary life, she died on March 9, 1957. So let's start today's lesson. Socrates lived in Athens about 400 years Jesus Christ was born. As a boy, he was ugly, undersized, and had a flat nose and bulging eyes. His father was a poor stone cutter. He was always rather shabbily dressed. So children, as I told you earlier also, that Socrates was born 470 years before Jesus Christ, before the Lord himself was born. And he was born in Athens. As Socrates belonged to a very poor family, his father was a laborer, he was a poor stone cutter, and they were financially very weak. So almost all the time Socrates was very shabbily dressed. And this is a new term for you, bulging. The meaning of this word is coming out. Like other boys of his age, he went to school where the most important lessons were music and gymnastics. He also learned some science and mathematics and a little about the stars, but not nearly so much history and geography as children learn today. This strange little creature with a short neck and plain face was a thoughtful child. He watched his companion all the time and allowed very few things to escape his notice. You must have noticed something very interesting in these lines. And that interesting thing is the subjects. You must have read that the subject, like music, like gymnastics, the subjects which we consider as secondary subjects these days were considered as the most important subjects in that age when Socrates was a child. And the subjects like maths, like science, history, geography, which are very important subjects these days, were considered as the secondary subject in that age. So these things must be remembered to understand about that age. If we talk about Socrates, he was exceptionally observant child. He kept on observing each and everything around him, each and every child, each and every person around him. Socrates did not have a big house or fine furniture. He did not seem to want either wealth or beautiful possessions. As he grew older, he began to think very little for bodily comfort and pleasure. He gave his mind to all that was noble, honorable, and just. As Socrates was not at all an ordinary child, for him, all worldly temptations, all worldly possessions, all these things, all these material things were of no use. For him, the most important things were that everything which was just, which was novel, because he was an extraordinary child. Socrates went around the town on foot and talked to people. The Athenians began to look for his familiar figure in the streets and to say to their friends, "Yes, that's Socrates. Come along and talk to him." After some time, Socrates became famous as a teacher. He wandered along the roads and stood in the marketplaces, talking to anyone who cared to greet him. His listeners were often confused after they had argued with him, answered his questions. Socrates told his countrymen that everyone must learn to think for himself, so that by using his reason, he would have the power to see what was right, just, true, and beautiful, and so shape his own conduct. He wanted Athens to be a perfect state. He told everyone, both his pupils and his other followers, that this could only happen if every citizen educated his own mind to see what was right and noble. He believed that questioning and discussing would help them do this, and so he was forever talking to them in the open streets. Children, before I explain these lines, I would suggest you to keep your books open for a better understanding. So these lines say that Socrates had a habit of roaming here and there, of talking to people. He kept on walking in the open streets, in the marketplaces, and whosoever wanted to talk to him, whosoever wanted to discuss anything with him, he was always open for each and every person. So gradually he became a very popular, a very familiar, a very well-known figure in Athens. People started recognizing him as a teacher. And the most important thing he taught to everybody was to learn to differentiate between what was right and what was wrong, so that they could shape their conduct in a best possible way. And in this way, the Athens could be a perfect state. And one thing is very important, that Socrates believed in the power of discussing, in the power of conversing with people. And almost all the time, he tried to discuss, he tried to converse in the open places, so that maximum number of people may involve in that discussion, they may take part in that conversation. When Socrates was an old man, his fame had spread far and wide. The house of many a rich man opened its doors to him, for people felt honored to have him as their guest. By degrees, a special group of pupils gathered around him and followed him wherever he went. Among them was a young man called Plato, who treasured every word which his master uttered. and in later years became famous as a teacher as Socrates himself. Children, you must have noticed a word here, pupil. There are two words, P-E-O-P-L-E is pronounced as people, and the meaning of this word is person or public. And here you must have noticed another word, P-U-P-I-L, and the pronunciation of this word is pupil, and the meaning is disciple or student. In Hindi, we call pupil shishya. So, I was telling you that gradually, by and by, Socrates became a very famous person, and by the old age, he was honored so well that almost all the rich persons of the country, they wanted to take him as their guest so that they would be honored themselves. And here is a very important name, Plato. Plato was the most favorite pupil or most favorite disciple of Socrates. You must have heard a name, Aristotle. Do you know who was Aristotle? Aristotle was the disciple of Plato, and Plato was the disciple of Socrates. And all these three persons, Socrates, Plato, and Aristotle, all these three persons were great philosophers. But the credit of bringing Socrates to the world goes to this man, Plato, because Plato was the person who treasured each and every saying, who treasured each and every teaching, each and every preaching of his guru or of his master, who was Socrates. But although many people loved the old man and delighted in his wisdom, there were some who did not approve of him. He taught that men's own mind influenced his conduct more than the gods. This seemed to some people a new and wicked idea. He said that there were higher and nobler deeds than making sacrifices to Athens and the other gods of Greece. And many people thought that he was leading the young astray, questioning all that they had been taught to believe and filling their minds with doubt. Children, you must have heard that literature is the medium of opening an era to the people. And these lines, they are like bringing to us the fact that animal sacrifice was very popular practice in Athens in those days. And Socrates, being a very kind-hearted and a very noble man, he was against these practices. He believed that there are better things, there are better deeds to be done. And as many persons were his critics, so a big group of people was also who were against Socrates. The men who were governing Athens summoned Socrates to appear before them and to stand his trial. His friends begged him to escape or to hide until the storm had blown over. But Socrates was no coward. He knew that he had done nothing wrong and that he had only taught what he believed to be just, true and honorable. And so he went to the court. His clothes and shoes were dusty and travel stained, but everyone knew that a noble heart beat under this shabby garments. As I told you, that a big group of persons was there who were against Socrates, who were against his beliefs, who were against his teachings. And almost all of them were the part of the government of Athens. So these powerful persons, they sent a summon to Socrates and they called him to the court. Socrates had a big group of his well-wishers also, a big group of his pupils also. So these well-wishers, these peoples, they suggested him to remain underground for some time. But Socrates knew, he was confident enough that he had done nothing wrong. So he denied to remain underground and he decided to move towards the court. And as there were no means of transport in those days, so he had to walk on foot that long distance. And because of covering that long distance on foot, when he reached in the court, he himself was very dirty, his clothes were dirty, his shoes were dirty, everything was very dusty and dirty. But whosoever knew Socrates knew that a very kind, a very noble, a very pure heart was beating under this shabby, this dirty body. He made a powerful and dignified speech. He told Athenians that they would again nothing by taking away the last few years of his life, but that he was willing to die many deaths for what he believed to be right. And when Socrates reached in the court, a big crowd was there along with these persons belonging to government. A big crowd was there, and before everybody, Socrates made a very powerful, very dignified speech, and he told that I knew I would be punished, but I am ready to die thousands and thousands of deaths for the well-being of my beloved country. And he also said that I am a very old person and soon I would be facing a natural death. So these people can harm in no possible way, because I am already an old man and soon I am going to die. But I am ready to die many deaths for the well-being of my beloved country. The judges listened to him, questioned him and condemned him to death. The old man made no complaint. He leaned on his stick, looking round the crowded courtroom. Plato and his other pupils were there in the court all the time. No evil can happen to a good man, he told them, either in life or after death. So be of good cheer. I have to go, the hour of my departure has arrived, and we go our ways. I to die, you to live. And as it was pre-decided, the whole system of the court was merely a formality, his death sentence was pre-decided, and finally he was condemned to death. So his pupils, his family members and other persons who were his well-wishers, they became very sad. But Socrates taught them that there is no reason of getting upset, because both the paths are of glory and both have different paths. He means Socrates, he was moving towards the path of his death, and the other persons would surely move towards the path of their life. Then the soldiers came and took him away to prison. His wife followed with his three children. Many of his favorite pupils were also with him. For a long time they talked to him, and he taught them many wise lessons which they treasured in their hearts. But all the time his friends knew that Socrates would die soon. They were sad, for as Plato wrote, he was like a father of whom we were being bereaved, and we were about to pass the rest of our lives as orphans. Children, Socrates has had three children and all the three were sons. His wife, his three sons, his pupils, all were there. When policemen came and when they were taking him towards the prison, all these persons were also with him, and all the time they were discussing something, and Socrates was kept on teaching them, and they all knew that these were the last teachings of Socrates to them, so they were very keen to listen to him. But all the time there was something said within the heart of their hearts, because they knew that very soon this man was going to die. As Plato has mentioned later on, that all of them, they knew that very soon they were going to become the orphans, because Socrates was no less than a father to them. After the sun had set behind the treetops, the jailer came in and asked Socrates to prepare for death. It means in the time of evening he was condemned to death. In Athens, when people were condemned to die, they were given a cup of poison. Socrates knew this and he nodded to the jailer, who looked at him sadly, saying, "You, Socrates, whom I know to be the noblest and gentlest and best of all who ever came to this place, will not be angry when I ask you to drink the poison, for others and not I are the guilty cause." Bursting into tears, he went out and returned with a cup of poison. Children, in those days, it was a culture in Athens that whenever a person was condemned to death, he was offered a cup of poison and he had to drink that cup of poison. And when the jailer asked Socrates to prepare for death, it means he was asking him to prepare to drink the cup of poison. And Socrates knew this custom and he was all set to drink the cup of poison. But as the jailer himself was a follower of Socrates, so he had tears in his eyes, but he had to perform his duty. He begged for pardon and he said that, "I am not responsible for your death, and you are the noblest person whosoever had come to that place. May the gods prosper my journey from this to the other world," said Socrates, and lifted the cup to his lips. And when the jailer came with a cup of poison, Socrates took that cup of poison and he lifted that cup of poison to his lips. And while touching that cup, Socrates said, "May the gods prosper my journey from this to the another world. May my journey to the world of God be prospered." His pupils tried to keep back their tears, but one sobbed aloud, and this distressed the others, and soon the room was filled with his sound of weeping. As you know, that sobbing is very infectious. Whenever a person sobs, whenever a person cries, it becomes very difficult to control your own sobs, to control your own cries, and that too when you are that much connected to the person who was departing. Although Socrates had ordered everybody that nobody would going to cry at his death, but since one could not control his sob and the whole courtroom was filled with the sound of sobbing, Socrates paused with the unfinished cup of poison in his hands. "What's this strange noise?" he asked. "I have heard that a man should die in peace. You must not cry. Be silent and have patience." So he stopped with the unfinished cup and he said that, "Stop crying. One should go to the word of God in peace. One should die in peace." He looked around, remembering something. "Crito," he whispered to one of his pupils, can you do me a favor? And all of a sudden, he remembered something, as if something great was missing, and he remembered all of a sudden. And he very slowly, whisper is also a new term for you, whisper is saying something very slowly. And said Crito, if he would do a favor for him. I owe a cock to Asclepius, will you pay the debt? So he said, Socrates said to Crito that he owe a cock to Asclepius. Would he pay the debt? It shall be paid, said Crito. And suddenly Crito replied that he would surely pay the debt. Is there anything else? And he again asked if there anything else. He waited for some time. He waited for the answer from the Socrates side. But there was no answer, for Socrates, the greatest of all the Greeks, was dead. Crito waited for some time for the answer from Socrates' side, but alas, Socrates has gone to the another world. He has gone to the world of God. He was no more. So children, this was the lesson. This was a very appealing life history of the greatest philosopher, Socrates. And this life history of Socrates teaches us to remain noble, to remain just, and to always work for the betterment of one's country. Okay. Now, look at the weightage of marks allotted to the prose section in board examination. Total 16 marks are allotted to prose sections. And here I have prepared a very small list of word meanings, and all these word meanings are very important. Have a quick look. And these are 8 important short questions. Who was Socrates? What do you think? What do you know about him? Where did Socrates live? Describe his physical appearance. How, according to Socrates, should man use his reason? What was Socrates accused of? Who summoned him to appear before them to stand his trial? Remember all these questions. And these are important long questions. Who was Socrates? What did he teach the people? Why did he become famous? Who was Socrates? Describe his physical features and early education. Why was Socrates condemned to death? How did he react to the sentence of death? And children, these 4 are important passages for comprehension. Have a quick look at them. And finally, the recapitulation. Children, first of all, we have discussed about AD and BC. And then we learned about the author, Rhoda Power. Then a detailed description of the lesson, Socrates was there. And we had some important word meanings. Then I gave you 8 short questions, and after that 5 long questions and 4 comprehension passages. Children must remember that if you understand this lesson and if you prepare all these questions well, you would surely score good marks. So that's all for today's lesson. Thank you. Have a nice day.